Want to remix your business? Check out the book at crossindustryinnovation.com. Star Wars fans had a rough ride for many years. First, George Lucas recut the original films to incorporate garish, artificial-looking CGI. Then he produced a trio of popular but largely disliked prequels that featured more garish, artificial-looking CGI, along with flat characters, convoluted plots, and Jar Jar. Lightsabers were wilting among the faithful. The J.J. Abrams-directed The Force Awakens was the Star Wars movie fans were looking for, and it was greeted with overwhelming praise.
The Force Awakens is one of the most entertaining movies I've seen.
I love that movie.
If I'd walked out of the theater, turned left, and Episode 8 was playing, I would have gone right in.
But even among those who loved it, there was a recurring criticism.
Don't be fooled, young Eli. J.J. Abrams never told you how he recycled the story.
Basically, it is A New Hope with another family plot in there.
On more than a few occasions, you're like, I've seen that.
I wanted something new, and I didn't really get that.
This core complaint was echoed more strongly elsewhere. It was called the biggest fan film ever made. Some claimed our culture suffers from a nostalgia problem. Others said it was an indicator of the stagnation and repetition of our collective imagination. And the film was also called a remix, which seemed to not be a compliment. It was even dubbed the apotheosis of remix culture, its logical endpoint. The remix method of copying, transforming, and combining is definitely used in The Force Awakens as well as the other works of J.J. Abrams. Is remixing a weak point in The Force Awakens? Is the remix method growing stale? Have we reached the limits of remixing? J.J. Abrams is well acquainted with the concept of remixing, but he's a different kind of remixer than George Lucas. Lucas tended to copy scenes and shots, while Abrams tends to copy major story elements. This is something he's done from the very beginning of his career, and his earliest screenplays loyally follow established story templates. Taking Care of Business is about a rich man and a poor man swapping identities, a formula that was established in Mark Twain's Prince and the Pauper, then used in many films, including the hit Trading Places. Regarding Henry came out in the midst of a trend of films about people with intellectual disabilities teaching us life lessons and being adorable.
This is dancing.
In Gone Fishin', the disaster-prone lead characters narrowly escape a string of misfortunes and triumph in the end, a comedy tradition that dates back to at least Buster Keaton. Abrams' voice becomes more distinct as he starts to transform and combine his sources more. The influence of Steven Spielberg emerges in Joyride, a killer truck movie that resembles Spielberg's Duel, crossed with a road trip film. The TV series Felicity was his take on the popular self-aware teen drama genre of the 90s, and it incorporates some unusual elements, like a Twilight Zone-style episode and this shocking twist.
I am down, but I am not in any way out.
His next show, Alias, was a Felicity-like college drama crossed with a spy thriller. Abrams' first big success was Lost, which took the stranded on an island genre of Survivor and Castaway and added the non-linear timeline popularized by Quentin Tarantino and the surreal plot twists of The Twilight Zone. Since graduating to the big screen, Abrams' specialty has been rebooting familiar material. Mission Impossible 3 was an Alias-like version of the Tom Cruise vehicle and renewed an aging franchise. Super 8 was directed in the style of Spielberg and resembled a monster movie version of E.T. And his Star Trek films successfully relaunched the franchise while pleasing most, if not all, of the existing fans. So with this knack for updating and refreshing familiar material, Abrams brought his remix-like approach to Star Wars Episode 7. The Force Awakens incorporates a bit of George Lucas-style remixing. There's a shot inspired by Apocalypse Now, the X-Wing skimming over the water was taken from the film Firefox, and the sword fight in Gently Falling Snow recalls Kill Bill, which itself copied Lady Snowblood. But most of the remixing in The Force Awakens is of story elements, and the primary source is Episode 4, A New Hope. In both films, an old Jedi must be found. Vital information is tucked away in a cute droid. On a desert planet, the droid is found by a young orphan. Stormtroopers search for the vital information and kill innocent people. Our heroes narrowly escape in the Millennium Falcon. The orphan forms a relationship with an elder figure. Han Solo has a confrontation with someone he owes money. There's a space bar filled with wacky creatures where our heroes are stared at in silence for a moment. The villains have a planet-like weapon that destroys planets. This is also the second time J.J. Abrams has destroyed a planet. The villain murders the elder figure, which the orphan witnesses. The heroes go into the planet-like weapon to incapacitate something. Ships fly down a trench, shoot a particular spot, and destroy it. This is the third time in the series this has happened. There's even a joke.
How do we blow it up? There's always a way to do that.
Which suggests there's a twist coming, but then there isn't. And there's also elements copied from the original Star Wars that seem like they really should have been changed. The First Order, like the Empire, is modeled on Nazis, despite there being no significant Nazi threats since 1945. And the Jedi are again a semi-mythical clan, despite sensationally saving the galaxy only a few decades earlier. Maybe they left the record-keeping to the Ewoks. The film certainly isn't all copying. There's plenty of transforming as well, especially in the characters. The hero is a woman, another lead is a former stormtrooper, and the villain is a raging, failure-prone fanboy. These changes provide some of the freshest narratives. So The Force Awakens clearly is a remix, but so is everything else. For as long as humans have been creating, we have been copying, transforming, and combining. The issue isn't the remixing in the film, it's that it's heavy on copying and lighter on transforming and combining. But this was an intentional choice. The Force Awakens was designed to be familiar because we love the familiar. That's why more and more of Hollywood's top hits are new versions of old stories. But familiarity isn't the only thing we love. We're also attracted to the novel, the unusual, the innovative. This is a smaller, riskier market, but it's influential, and it's where many of the most enduring films are born. The familiar and the novel both appeal to us. Think of them as two halves of a spectrum. Box office hits tend to land on the left, critical hits tend to land on the right. But some films land right in the middle, like the original Star Wars. It felt very novel because it blended previously unrelated pieces into a highly unusual and innovative package. Yet it also felt very familiar because it copied something well known, the mythical structure of countless heroic tales of the past. The result was something that strongly appealed to our desires for both the novel and the familiar. This target between the novel and the familiar is something we can all aim for. We can make our novel ideas more accessible and understandable and perhaps more impactful by copying familiar elements. And we can make our familiar ideas more fresh, exciting, and surprising by extensively remixing from diverse sources. And if you can create that perfect hybrid of the new and the old, the results can be explosive. Okay, one last thing. In the book, The Art of the Force Awakens, you can get a glimpse of the remix method at work. Most of these tags are references to remixing. Like this illustration includes an image of a water bear, a weird little microscopic creature. This one is very closely modeled on the Nazis' Nuremberg rally. This early image of Snoke was based on the Lincoln Memorial. Rey's speeder is a combination of Luke's speeder and a tractor. Maz Kanata was inspired by Abrams' high school teacher, Rose Gilbert. And with this image, the artist thought he was copying this scene from The Right Stuff, which he believed featured a girl dressed as a mermaid, but it actually doesn't. So he thought he was copying, but he was actually transforming. And one last piece of evidence that suggests the team behind The Force Awakens were intentionally remixing is Rey's last name, Mixer. Rey Mixer. Get it? Or perhaps someone working on the book was just having a little fun. You be the judge. Hi, everybody, and welcome back to Everything is a Remix. First things first, we have a new Kickstarter campaign with awesome Star Wars-inspired t-shirts. The first is an Empire Strikes Back style design. The other is our nod to the opening sequence of the very first Everything is a Remix. And you can get the beta edition of The Remix Method, a short book about using remix techniques in your work. And that is available exclusively via Kickstarter. And all shipped orders come with free stickers. And if you'd like to see more free videos from me, come back me on Patreon. Right now when you back, you also get access to my video on demand series, This Is Not a Conspiracy Theory. I hope you enjoyed the video, and if there is sufficient interest, there should be at least a few more of these. They won't be an episodic series like the original four videos were. They will each be independent installments. But if you guys are still enjoying them, I think I've got a few more in me. My thanks to the awesome people at Cross Industry Innovation, MailChimp, Provoke, and XOXO for their support. And thank you to Ray Kimber, Antonio Garcia, and Youssef Abdelmohsen for their help. Up next for me is the fourth episode of This Is Not a Conspiracy Theory, and it should be epic. You can check out that site at thisisnotaconspiracytheory.com. Thanks so much for watching, and I will see you next time. Remix. To combine or edit existing materials to produce something new. The term remix originally applied to music. It rose to prominence late last century during the heyday of hip-hop, the first popular music form to...